All right, guys, let's get started on the solutions for the Fall 2011 Exam 2. So for the first page, there's just two questions. The first one is just constructing a confidence interval and answering questions based on that. The second question is a series of true-false questions. All right, so for the first question, parents helping underage children lie to get on Facebook. So a survey shows that parents are helping their children lie to get online. So for the survey, the sample size was 645 parents, ages 26 and older, that have a 10 to 12-year-old children living with them. And of these 645 patients, they found that 248 knew their underage children were signed up for Facebook. So for part A, you just want to compute a general 99% confidence interval for the proportion of all such parents whose underage child is signed up for Facebook. So the first thing you want to do when constructing a confidence interval is find your p hat. So in this case, p hat is just 248 out of 645 parents who knew that their underage children was signed up for Facebook. And so, calculating that out, you should get 0.3845. And remember, you want to round out to four decimal places. So the next step is calculating your Z star, or finding your Z star. So your Z star is based on the fact that it's a 99% confidence interval. So if you go to your formula card, for table A2, you can look up the 99% confidence level and find your Z star right down here. So 2.576. All right. So 2.576. Okay, so now the next step is, since you want to calculate a general confidence interval, you want to compute the standard error for p hat. And the formula for that is p hat 1 minus p hat over n. So from there, you just plug in the numbers for p hat and n. So 0.3845 times 1 minus 0.3845 divided by your sample size of 645. And you should get something like 0.0192. All right, and then from there, you just put all the elements together. So you have your p hat, 0.3845, plus or minus your margin of error, which is just Z star, so 2.576 times the standard error for p hat, so 0.0192. And then calculating that out, you should get a lower bound of 0.3352 and an upper bound of 0.4338. All right, so now that you have your confidence interval in part A, the next part is to pick the following correct interpretation for the 99% confidence level. So I'll just go through each of these statements one by one. The first statement, the probability that the true proportion of all such parents with an underage child on Facebook falls between the bounds calculated in part A is 0.99. So once you've constructed your interval, like in part A, the true proportion either falls within that interval or it doesn't fall within that interval. So the probability is 0 or 1. You can't have a probability of 0 or 0.99. So 1 is wrong. The second statement, the probability that the sample proportion of parents with an underage child on Facebook falls between the bounds calculated in Part A is 0.99 for repeated random samples of 645 parents. So the thing is for statement 2, it's referencing the sample proportion. And the sample proportion always falls inside your interval because that's what you're constructing the interval around. So 2 is also completely wrong. For statement 3, the true proportion of all such parents with an underage child on Facebook falls between the bounds calculated in Part A 99% of the time. Statement 3 and statement 1 are basically saying equivalent things. And again, the true proportion, once you calculate your interval, the true proportion either falls in 0% of the time or 100% of the time. So statement 3 is also totally false. Which, by process of elimination, leaves you with statement 4. The true proportion of all such parents with an underage child on Facebook falls between the bounds of 99% of the possible confidence intervals resulting from repeated random samples of 645 parents. This statement is completely correct. All right, so the next question, Part C, how would the conservative 99% confidence interval compare to the interval calculated in Part A? So since in Part A you calculated a general interval, C is just asking you to compare a general confidence interval and a conservative confidence interval. And for conservative confidence intervals, you want to be conservative, so you want to include more values. So the confidence interval is always going to be wider, unless if p hat equals 0.5, in which case they are the same length. All right, so now to move on to the next question. Question 2. And as I said before, question 2 is just a series of true or false questions. So for A, it would be appropriate to set the significance level alpha to 0.01 if incorrectly rejecting H naught was not very consequential. So your alpha is the probability of a type 1 error, so rejecting H naught when H naught is true. So if you're setting alpha to a very low value, like 0.01, you're saying that you want the probability of rejecting H0 when H0 is true to be very low, which means that rejecting H0 would be very consequential. So, therefore, since you set your alpha value to be low, if the consequences for rejecting H0 were severe, then A is false. So for B, if we pool variances from two samples for a common estimate of the variance, sigma squared, then our pooled 95% confidence interval for mu1 minus mu2 would be narrower than an unpooled confidence interval. And this is, in general, this is true because your degrees of freedom for the pooled version are greater than your degrees of freedom for the general version. So, but there are some rare cases where the confidence intervals for the pooled and unpooled version are the same length. So for this question, we would have either accepted true or false. But the answer we were getting at is true. All right, so for the last one, if a result is significant at the level alpha of 0.01, then it would be significant at the level alpha of 0.05. Since you're testing significance by seeing if p-value is less than alpha, and a result is significant if p-value is less than alpha, then if a number is less than 0.01, it's also less than 0.05. So part C is true.